You know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lorded over them, their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus! You gotta do me a solid. You gotta do me a favor. I just want this one thing from you. It's really, really small, but would you do that for me, please, 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 pretty, please? Just let me sit at your right hand as you come in glory. When you sit on a gigantic heavenly throne with a gigantic heavenly crown, and you're like way up here, can we be like here? And everyone else be like here? It's a small thing we ask, but you and I, we're tight. Jesus, just do us this little favor, pretty, please. And Jesus says, verily I tell you, there ought no such thing as a dumbeth question, except that one, for that is a dumb question. And he has to disabuse them of their full and complete misunderstanding of what glory means within the kingdom of God. From all the examples that they were familiar with, comfortable with, and understood, being great meant being awesomely above everyone else. That you shined so brightly in your splendor and in your grandeur that everyone else just had to shrink back and say, you are super special. Way more special than me. For you are great, and I am lowly. And so they were close with Jesus. These are some of his best friends. They have been with him through thick and through thin. They have seen amazing and miraculous things, and they've been a part of it. And yet even these guys get it completely and fully backwards, upside down, in the wrong way. And they ask a seriously dumb question. Jesus, when you are glorified, we want to be like Vice Jesus. Like your number two guy. Is that all right? I mean, if nobody's already applied, we're friends, and I thought maybe you could throw me a bone, and no, if you didn't have any plans for the position, I'm just saying I'm available. Because I like it when people look up to me. I like it when people think that I'm pretty cool, and I'm pretty great, and I'm pretty awesome. I like it when I walk by and everybody knows. To be great. And it's a dumb question because it fully misunderstands that Jesus, the greatest among us, God Almighty, maker of all that there is seen and unseen, he humbles himself, taking the form of a servant. And when he shows greatness, he shows it by washing the feet of the disciples. When he shows greatness, he shows it by touching the untouchable, loving the unlovable. When he shows his greatness, he shows it stripped and beaten and bloody and dying on a cross. You see, that's great. And you've got it backwards. So if you're asking me, hey, Jesus, can I be spit on and beaten and die horribly and painfully? Can I do that too? That's what you're asking. Can you drink that particular cup? Can you walk in those particular shoes? And they don't know, and they don't understand. And they say, oh yeah, sign me up. I want to be number two. And he says, no. If you want to be truly great, in a way that greatness really counts in the eyes of God and that shines eternally, if you want to be great that way, first you've got to be good. You want to be awesome? All right. be humble. You want to be super, okay? Be a servant. You want to be like Jesus in his glory, and understand that that comes through power and might, love, and service, and obedience, and grace. It's a dumb question, but he turns it back around, and he reminds them about who he really is, and what that really ought to mean for them, and for their own lives. Now, we have had three readings now from the book of Job. We will conclude next Sunday. So I want to recap briefly so that we can kind of catch up what's happened. You know, Job is a rather lengthy book, and in order to get it in just 3 or 4 weeks, you have to kind of skip a bunch of stuff and hit highlights. So in our very first week, we got to see Job at his absolute worst, the worst, worst, worst day of his life, where Job, who had it made, loses everything. He loses all his stuff. Things are crushed or destroyed or stolen or burned down. He loses friends. He loses servants. He loses people he counts on and depends on, and they're dead and they're gone and they're murdered. And he loses his own children, burned up in a fire and crushed by a falling building. Everything that this guy has, systematically removed, eliminated, destroyed. He remains faithful. The Lord giveth, the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Then comes the pain, not just on the inside with all of his loss, but on the outside, covered head to toe in sores, where all he can do is just lay there and groan. You know, you can't get comfortable, you can't lay on your back or on your side, you can't sit, you can't stand. There is just nothing but agonizing pain. And that lovely wife who says, curse God and die, refuses. Will I not accept suffering from the Lord when I will accept good things? And so last week, we saw in that misery, in that shame, and in that pain, he had friends come. The friends sat with him for a week, just in silence, just in compassion, just to be there with him. And then after a week, they get tired, and they want to teach him. Clearly, they say to Job, you have screwed up royally. Clearly, you have some horrific sin that you must repent of, because nobody would have these sorts of terrible circumstances unless God was supernaturally punishing them for some really terrible transgression. And so, we go chapter by chapter where they kind of argue with each other. And the arguments of these friends, they're kind of sensible. There's sort of a common sense prudence to them. There's kind of a, you do bad, you get bad. Sort of a karma kind of talk about it. But they are also very rightly pointing to the justice of God. God is not unjust. God is not whimsical or capricious. There are real consequences to sin. But each time Job says, fine, but no. I have done nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing to deserve this. And even if I've done something, which I don't think I did, you can't convince me that it merits the death of my kids. Come on. I don't know what's going on. I trust the Lord. He is just and he is righteous. All the more that I wish he could just be here right now. Like a judge in a courtroom, I would lay out my case and I know the verdict would be in my favor. I know God would listen to my side of the story. He would vindicate me. He would make things right. He would tell you that this is not my fault, and he would make things okay. I trust him. I know him. Another chapter of friends. Oh, you're crazy, Job. Just confess, Job. Just confess. We all know that bad things happen to bad people, good things happen to good people, and you have done something wrong. To be one of God's people means you're filled with provisions and things and stuff and goodness and happiness. People who struggle in life, they struggle because of a lack of faith. People have hard times, they have hard times because God is punishing them for their wickedness, so they would turn and trust Him more. And Job says, no. No. I don't get this, I don't understand it, but that is not right. And finally, after a fourth friend comes, young Elihu, who has decided he's had enough of these old geezers spouting off nonsense, and he, as a wise, wise teenager, 20-something-year-old, I mean, you guys are filled with wisdom, trust me. Now he's going to set them straight. And Elihu talks for like 3 chapters, maybe. I mean, he kind of goes on and on and on, because once you give a young person the stage, I mean, they've got stuff to say. They know. And yet Job remains steadfast. I trust in the Lord, but I've not done anything. Help me, help me, help me. Listen to my plea. Listen to my cry. Vindicate me, righteous judge. And now we get to our reading. For you see, like the disciples, Job thought he knew what he was talking about. And Job has asked a dumb question. Job is basically crying out to God to say, why is this happening to me? Why are you doing this to me? Why are you letting this happen? Why won't you be just? Won't you be righteous? Won't you fix things so that it's right? Because I don't deserve this. And what we read was the answer that God has for Job. Who in the world do you think you are? The end. I mean, not really, because, you know, he takes like a chapter to say that, but that's kind of the point. God says, who do you think you are to ask me that question? You could not understand the answer. And to be frank, you don't even understand the question well enough to ask it. Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. I need to pull up King James here because I never get to say this. Because this is what it actually says. Gird your loins. Put on your big boy pants. And let's have a discussion here. Mr. Big Britches. You are demanding from me an answer to your complaints. And now I'm going to remind you. You have no idea what you're talking about. Were you there when I made the heavens and the earth? Did you watch me string the stars across the cosmos? When I laid the foundations of the earth, did you pour the footer? Do the waves listen to you and stop, or you tell them to stop? Why are you even asking this question as though you could understand the answer? And if this seems like a harsh rebuke, it really isn't as bad as I think it might sound. This is less chastisement than it is correction. Like in our Gospels, Jesus didn't say, James and John, that's the dumbest question I've ever heard. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul. Get out. Everyone is now dumber for having listened to that question. He didn't say that. He teaches them, and then restores them. And I think God is doing this with Job. It is hard. There's a bit of a smackdown happening, but it is one that comes out of love and care, because remember that Job has his trust in the Lord. Job has not tried to justify himself because he's great. Job has simply put his faith in the justice and in the mercy of God. But now that his complaint has turned to why God hasn't acted or fixed this, God needs to disabuse him of this notion that somehow Job himself is the judge. Oh God, I have looked at your handiwork. This is where I find it lacking. I'm going to make a list, if you don't mind. All the things that I think you've done wrong. Oh, you missed another one. I'm sorry, that's going to cost you. And God is just basically saying, you don't understand how things work. In your finite human mind, how can you possibly conceive and understand infinitude? Job is right to rest on the mercy and on the justice of God. But as soon as we shake our fists and demand our rights, we step outside of that mercy and say, we understand things well enough to know, I want to get what's coming to me. Oh, no, you don't. You think you do, but that's actually a dumb question. So God reminds Job and all of us of our smallness, of our need, and of our humility. As Jesus reminds James and John that to be great means to be a servant, to be awesome means to be humble, God reminds Job, you were right when you relied on a mercy that is mysterious and beyond your understanding. So don't assume that you can put all the pieces together, that you understand and then can make demands. You wouldn't understand the answer even if I told you. And if you were honest with yourself, you would realize you don't understand things well enough to even ask the question in the first place. To rely on God's mercy, to rely on God's love, to not demand our rights, but to receive His grace. Even in our suffering, even in the hardships, even in the pain. I started our discussions about Job weeks ago with reminding you, I don't think there are any coincidences. They're just those blessed, gracious moments where we get kind of a peek behind the curtain. And we can see how all of the threads intertwine in a beautiful tapestry of God's glory. We can't take that tiny glimpse and then assume we've got the whole picture. We can't take those tiny pieces or what's laid out before us and say, I got it. I understand it all. And instead of doing this, you really ought to do that. God, I see what you're trying there, but it's not going to work. You need to do it my way. But instead, in humility, that's where we will find our greatness and our closeness to God. Not in our demands, not in our superiority. Being a servant, being humble, and grateful. Now, one of the things we skipped over bears some specific explanation. For those of you who were here on Sunday afternoon as we thanked God for the life and the witness of our friend Cliff, for those of you who have been to any service here as a funeral or memorial that we use the burial of the dead right to, that service, whether it begins with a song or quietly, the words actually start with an M. I am resurrection, I am life, says the Lord. Whoever has faith in me shall have life, even though he die. Everyone who has life and has committed himself to me in faith shall not die forever. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives. The last who will stand upon the earth. After my awakening, he will raise me up. Is this familiar so far? Mm-hmm. And in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see in my eyes. Behold him who is my friend and not a stranger. None of us has life in himself. None becomes his own master when he dies. For if we have life, we are alive in the Lord. If we die, we die in the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, We are the Lord's possession. Happy from now on are those who die in the Lord. So it is as in spirit they rest from their labors. And in one brief moment, like a beautiful tapestry, we see stitched together scripture verses of not only God's promises, but our faith. This is our perspective going into a burial service. This is our foundation as we say, I miss this person whom I love, whom I know. In this mortal life, I will not see them again, no matter how much I want, no matter how much I try. For here and for now, they are gone. So what is my hope? What is my conviction? These words from Scripture. Okay, resurrection, and redeemers, and spirit, all New Testament stuff, right? No. Starts off with John 11, where Jesus is speaking words of truth and comfort to Martha at the grave of her brother Lazarus, where Jesus says, I am resurrection, I am. Later on, these are words that Paul writes to the Romans in Romans 14. Whether we live or die, together, all of us, we are the Lord's possession. We don't belong just to ourselves. Together, we belong to Him. And then finally, happy are those who die in the Lord, for they rest from their labors, is a promise all the way at the end of the Bible in the book of Revelation. So what about that section in the middle? What about the Redeemer who lives? That is Job. Old Testament, a life of suffering, a life of pain, and a life of hardship. And while everyone's trying to convince him that he's done wrong, that he's done bad, and that all he really needs to do is confess because bad things only happen to bad people, he says, as for me, this life is a nightmare. My life is miserable and painful, and I have cried so much I have no more tears left. But I know that my Redeemer lives. The last he will stand upon the earth. But this life of pain is not the end. But when it's over, there is more to come. And my living Redeemer will raise me up. He will wake me up from my slumber in the grave, and in my body I shall see God. I myself shall see him who is not a stranger. He's made the heavens and the earth. He spangled the stars in the sky. He laid the foundations of all creation. He's the maker of all that there is, seen and unseen, but he is no stranger to me, because when he raises me up, I will see my friend. That's Job. Why do you read Job, man? That's what a downer book. It's sad. Yes, it is. So are life sometimes. But this is the hope of Job, and this is the hope of the church, and this is the hope of every Christian. No matter how bad things get, no matter how bad we screw up, or no matter how bad we've done the right thing and everything else is screwed up around us, no matter how hard it is, how sad it is, how scary it is, how painful it is, no matter how much loss, no matter how much tragedy, whether we think we're pretty great in this world, or whether we think we're pretty awful. As for me, I know that my Redeemer lives. At the last he will stand upon the earth. After my awakening, he will raise me up. In my body I shall see God. I myself shall see and my eyes behold him who is my friend and not a stranger. The faith of Job. The faith of the church. The faith of a Christian. There is more still to come. And when he raises you up, on the last day, on the first day of all things still to come, And in his holy resurrection, you will see God. And he will be no stranger to you. For he who made the heavens and the earth, he knows your pain, he knows your weakness. And in the end, he will raise you up.